Ladies and gentlemen, good evening, and on behalf of the Council on Economic Policies, a very warm welcome to all of you. It's a true pleasure to have you join us for many reasons. One being that you found us, because there is another William White on stage today, as Thomas Held pointed out to me earlier, who's a musician, and the concert is called William White Residency and is out at the Escher Wiesplatz. So thank you for being here. Second, because this is not only the first CEP event this year, but it's actually also the very first CEP event that we organize here in Zurich. And finally, and most importantly, because you bring a tremendous diversity of views to the discussion here. Views that range from the perspective of the Swiss National Bank over to commercial and private banks, the corporate sector, members of government, members of parliament, and the media, as well as NGOs. And we believe that this reflects the fact that it's probably worthwhile to expand the discussion about monetary policy beyond the smaller economic circles in which it's already taking place today, and to advance our understanding on the effects of monetary policy on the broader societal issues that we collectively have on our agendas and care about. Thank you very much for being here. It's obviously also a unique pleasure and privilege to welcome our speaker, William White. Dr. White has been at the forefront of economic thinking and decision-making for, more than four decades. In a career that started in 1969 at the Bank of England, which then took him to the Bank of Canada, then on to the Bank for International Settlements in Basel, and now to the OECD, where he is the chairman of the Economic Development and Review Committee. He, and I quote from an article from Spiegel magazine, predicted the approaching financial crisis years before 2007 subprime meltdown. But central bankers preferred to listen to his great rival, Alan Greenspan, instead, with devastating consequences for the global economy. Bill, we are thrilled to have you here. We are thrilled to have you on board at CEP as an advisor. And I think it's fair to say that we could have thought of no one better to give today's speech on monetary policy and society. Bill, thanks for joining us. The floor is yours.
Well, let me start off by saying how pleased I am to see so many old friends and acquaintances, and it's a bit humbling to see so many of you here. We have le tout Zurich and the tout Suisse, I suppose. But it's a great pleasure. So thank you all for having come along. And I wanted to thank Alex, of course, too, for the invitation to come and speak to this really newly formed Council on Economic Policies. And I guess one of the thoughts that sort of came to my mind was, why do we need a new outfit like the Council on Economic Policies? You know, why do we need such an outfit? It seems to me that monetary policy, in a sense, has gone down a wrong path, and I'm going to be talking mostly about that in my presentation tonight. In that the assumption has been made that monetary policy really has effects only on nominal things, you know, that nominal, on prices, basically. And that the implications of monetary policy for the real economy are not really all that important. And I guess I have been saying for a long period of time with my colleagues at the BIS that monetary policy can actually have some pretty devastating effects on the real economy. And I'm thinking about the whole boom-bust cycle, credit, whatever. And these things have real effects, and we're living through, I mean, the last 5 or 6 years, we're living through the real effects of these policies, in my judgment. And they aren't just policies that have effects just on the real side. They also have effects on the political side and on the broader social side. And that's why I think sort of the agenda for the CEP on monetary policy is important. You know, they're interested in questions about income distribution, which is a real thing. They're interested in questions having to do with resource security and innovation. You know, can the Bill Gateses in the garages get the money in the middle of a credit-driven downturn? So I think these real side things, I'm not saying that I've got any answers here, but I'm saying I think these are really important questions that people should be doing serious research into. And that's why I'm pleased to be associated with the CEP. What I want to talk about today really is, in a certain sense, I guess the sort of mess that we're in and how we got into it. And perhaps most importantly, how the belief systems of all of the people, the economic agents, have sort of contributed to how we got to where we are. You know, what is it that people believed? And is it possible that some, in fact, possible even that many of those beliefs, in fact, were wrong, and that they've got to be changed? Let me start off. I hope I'm going to do this properly. I got one slide that's going to cover 150 years of, you will forgive me. I got one slide that's going to cover 150 years of academic thinking about economics. And the first point that I want to make here is that I think the classical economists, Smith, Ricardo, in a certain sense, had it right. And then I think we've had about 100 years where we basically got it wrong. And now I think there's a chance that we may be starting to think about economics in a way that will be useful once again. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, the first point is classical economics focused on social problems. I think that were of great importance. They focused on growth and the sources of growth, okay? Living standards. They focused on cycles, the question of crises and where they came from. And they also focused very importantly on the whole question of income distribution, you know, and the relationships between the classes, which I might point out takes economics and monetary policy beyond the realm of just economics, but into the broader questions of politics and power and the exercise of power. So that's sort of the way that these people sort of cut into it. And I think that they treated these things, these questions of growth cycles and income distribution, they tried to treat them in a highly interlinked and dynamic way, so that somehow growth and the process of growth had something to do with generating the downturns in the cycle. And that income distribution, which changed over the course of the cycle, had something to do with generating the upturns and the downturns. But it was all sort of part of a package. And that was sort of the way people looked at things really until, I guess, the end of the 18th century. And then sort of about 100 years ago, and I there's no point sort of going into the details, it would take days and days, somehow the whole thing morphed into a different method of analysis and a different sort of set of problems. People began to be much more worried about questions of the efficient use of resources at a moment in time, as opposed to those questions that I said the classics were mostly concerned about. And really, without sort of, what's the word, without periods of too much deviation from that, this sort of preoccupation with the efficient use of resources, and what I would now call, what we now call modern macroeconomics, has basically been in place ever since. And just to sort of focus at the moment on sort of where it's got us to now in terms of what gets taught in universities, and I think both at the undergraduate and the graduate level, is that we have a form of macro which essentially assumes away all the problems, and it separates out all the problems, so that when you start talking about sort of growth theory, well, growth is basically treated as exogenous. It's not sort of a question of very great interest. When we talk about the cycle and modern macro, the basic assumption is that the economy, if it's shocked away from equilibrium and full employment, will go back to it quite quickly and without really any serious interference from government or agencies of government. And insofar as income distribution is concerned, nobody's worried about income distribution for 40 years, really. You know? So these three things are all sort of treated as separate, and to the degree that they are treated, I'm thinking the cycle in particular, basically it's not a problem. The economy goes back to full employment. And whereas the classicists, I think, always sort of saw that money and credit and the banking system was somehow lurking behind everything and a source of both growth and problems, in modern macro, money really plays no important role. Credit is not there at all. There are no stocks in any of these models. So when you start thinking about like what got us into the problem, and I'll come back to this in a moment, things like credit and stocks and leverage and all that stuff, it's not in any of these models. So it's not at all surprising that people who relied on these models didn't see the crisis coming. They didn't take steps to prevent the crisis. They didn't take any steps to ensure that we would be able to manage a crisis when it did happen, because it couldn't happen. So, as I say, I think we've been off on a bit of a wrong path here. And I just, at the heart of it seems to me, is that the fundamental assumption here in the way that we've been looking at the economy in recent years is that the economy's sort of like an engine, okay? That you put something in, gasoline, and something comes out predictably at the other end, and you can model all of those relationships. I want to suggest here, and I think this is this last bullet, is that people seem increasingly to be realizing that the economy is not an engine, that it's not something mechanical that sort of operates the same way all the time, that in fact the economy is much more like an ecosystem. It's a complex, adaptive process. And the thing about looking at it that way, thinking about it as a complex, adaptive system, is that you realize that everything becomes sort of contingent, everything is path dependent, there's a highly sort of, a much greater likelihood of outcomes that are really nonlinear and very disruptive, even after periods of time when things have been very, very calm. So it seems to me that sort of thinking about the economy as a complex, adaptive system where you've got masses of people all interacting, all interdependent, all changing their behavior on the basis of what it is that they see other people do or think other people do or think other people are going to do is really sort of the way forward. And I'll be sort of referring to complexity here as I go rolling along. So 150 years of history of economic thought. What I want to talk about today is I basically want to say a few words about where we are at the moment in terms of the economy. I think we're in a place where we still face a lot of risks, and I'll go into some detail on that. Secondly, I want to go on and give a little bit of history about the conduct of monetary policy. Not analyzing the underlying reasons why people have done things, but just a history of what's been done. So as it were, to make a kind of prima facie case that maybe monetary policy is as much a problem as it is a solution. Then I want to go on and talk about belief systems, which includes the belief systems of basically all the, back to my complexity, all the big agents or groups of agents in the economy, the borrowers, the lenders, the regulators, the central bankers, the politicians, the voters. Why do people, what do they believe, and why do I think in large part what they believe might be wrong? Then I want to talk about the interactions between the economic agents, because it's not just, you sort of think about it as a complex system. It's not just the agents themselves, it's the way in which the agents interact. Maybe in ways that are helping to make the system more stable, or maybe, I think, in ways that make the system actually more unstable. And where that leads you to, I guess, in what will be my last slide, it leads you to the conclusion that we need to do two things. One, we have to identify false beliefs and try to change them. But the second thing we need to do is we need to make institutional changes, the interrelationships between those agents, so that they wind up interacting in ways that are more stabilizing than destabilizing. So that's basically what I want to talk about. Let me say a few words about the prospects for the global economy. The one thing that I think we can say is that this recovery, in spite of the most extraordinary monetary stimulus, and initially fiscal stimulus too, that the recovery from this recession has been extremely slow. And I would also note that if you start looking at the numbers, whether it be factor incomes or Gini coefficients for income distribution, the trends that we saw before are continuing, that income inequality continues to be getting worse in virtually every country you can think of. In fact, I think the only country that I can think of where the Gini coefficient has gone down in recent years is Brazil. And the reason for that is it couldn't go any higher. But virtually everywhere else you look, emerging countries, advanced market countries, inequality has been getting worse. I would note too that whereas the recession in the advanced market economies, which sort of started in 2009, the emerging market countries managed to hold themselves sort of exempt from it for a period of time. And there were even people who were saying the emerging markets are capable of leading the rest of us sort of out of the morass. But of course, in the course of the last couple of years, as you all know, even the emerging markets have been drawn into this period of very slow growth. And just have to pick up your newspapers in the course of the last couple of days to realize it might actually be getting worse, not better. Now, I am aware, because I do some work for the OECD, that both the OECD and the IMF basically say things are going to get better. The thing about complex systems is, and we know this not from economics, but from other studies of complex systems like communications, utilities, road networks, epidemics, whatever. We know that forecasting with any specificity is impossible in these systems. And so these guys are doing and women are doing the forecasts, but they have been very, very wrong in the past. I mean, I'm thinking, for example, the IMF WEO, and I'll single out the IMF because I don't do any work for the IMF. In the spring of 2008, their forecast for the advanced market economies was plus 3.8% GDP growth. And the actual outturn was minus 3.7. This has got to be the biggest forecasting error of all time. So when you start thinking about forecasting, don't think these people are infallible. I would also note, looking forward, even though the forecasts are for things are looking better, every region you look at in the world today, and I've already mentioned the emerging market economies, okay, particularly the ones with the big current account deficits, et cetera, et cetera. Every region you look at today, there are prima facie grounds for being worried. So you look at Japan, Abenomics. I won't go into any details here. I don't understand Abenomics, and what I do understand, I don't like. China. China has embarked, according to the new leadership, on a massive change in growth strategy. Two things. They said that 10 years ago, and nothing has happened. So it may or may not happen, we don't know. But if it doesn't happen, they got problems because they need to change their strategy. If it does happen, then we have a process of transition. And what we all know is that periods of transition are very dangerous. So Japan, China. The US is by no means out of the woods. Okay, the financial system has still got all sorts of problems with it. The participation rate is falling like a stone. There are still significant problems in the United States, to say nothing of the increase of concentration, which has been manifest over the course of the last few years. Europe, I'm not sure whether I should say Switzerland is a part of Europe, or but Switzerland is certainly and indisputably at the heart of Europe. So Switzerland knows that Europe is not out of the woods either. And I could give you a whole lecture on things that concern me, not least the short-term stuff. We'll do whatever it takes, whatever that means. But the longer-term stuff, we need to move to political union, economic union, fiscal union, economic union. Is it going to happen? We don't know. Because every time the market backs off, the politicians basically say, oh, that's fine, we don't need to do anything. So everywhere you look, I can see issues. And this bullet that says setbacks everywhere with repercussions everywhere, when you start thinking about the global economy as a complex, adaptive system where everything is linked up to everything else, what comes out of that? And the IMF and the OECD have actually done a lot of simulation work. And even with the models that I consider to be deficient, that work indicates that big troubles in any one part of the globe, largely via the financial system, get transmitted to all the other parts of the globe. So we have some issues here. And lastly, if we do get another downturn, what do we do? What do we do for macroeconomic encore? Okay. Interest rates are at zero. QEs are on. We're on QE3, QE4. There's very little evidence that these things do anything to restore solid, sustained, balanced growth. What do we do for an encore if things turn down? So, as I look ahead, I think we still have some problems. Now, why do I think that monetary policy is sort of prima facie part of the problem? How did we get into this? How did we get into this mess? Again, just one slide takes us back to 1945. So again, apologize. People want big picture stuff. This is sure big picture. The earliest period after the war was a period, I guess, where people really did believe that fine-tuning was possible, and that it could reduce the unemployment rate and keep it down, maybe at the expense of a small amount of inflation. And that was what sort of Joan Robinson used to refer to as bastard Keynesianism, because she felt it sort of basically omitted most of what Keynes had really been trying to say. And of course, what had happened by about the early 1970s was these policies of push, push, push led to the inflation period that began in the early 1970s, and of course, which culminated in stagflation and the Volcker disinflation. And about that time, too, of course, both Ed Phelps and Milton Friedman were pointing out the fact that the idea that there was a long-run Phillips curve, that you could actually get unemployment down with just a little bit more inflation, that was disproved, and the two of them, of course, won Nobel Prizes in consequence. The Volcker disinflation, and I just want to make this point, Volcker was there for a relatively short period of time, you know. When he left, and whenever it was, 86, he was then replaced by Alan Greenspan. And I guess my contention would be that we then got the first of the Greenspan puts in 1987. And I think you can make the case that it did lead to faster demand. And it did, in fact, sort of keep the economy going. But it came with a bunch of side effects, one of which I think was lower productivity growth, and the other one was rising income inequality. And it seems to me that, and these are assertions at this point, well, let me come back to this in a minute. Let me just sort of give you the history. So we had the Greenspan put in 87, and then I think we had a long period of more of the same, which was when the economy turned down in 1991, the answer again was massive reductions in interest rates. Then when the economy started to stall in 97 with the Asian crisis, when policy should have been tightening, it was just kept on hold. And then LTCM went down in 98, and the answer was exactly the same, monetary easing. And then we had 2001, and the answer was the same. And in each instance, if you go back and you look at the history, you see that the aggressiveness with which policy was eased was getting greater and greater. Because as we were running through all of this, these side effects that I was talking about, these financial and real side imbalances, what Alan Greenspan used to refer to as the headwinds of debt and other things, were getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And so then we had 2001. The answer was, as we all know, very aggressive monetary easing. And my contention would be that what that led to was still more financial imbalances, higher food and energy prices, and what it led to really was the crisis of 2007. So that as we went up to the 2007 thing, if you think back on that period of time and start thinking about imbalances, whatever that means, we had savings ratios that went down to a very, very low level in all the English-speaking countries. We had investment levels that went up to 45% of GDP in China. We had financial institutions that massively increased their leverage. We had credit spreads that went down to levels that had never been seen before. And virtually all of this was touted as being, this is the good news. But in the end, of course, these were symptoms that should have indicated that a crisis was on its way. And what have we had since 2007? Well, the answer is still more of the same. So when you think about the policies have all been designed to stimulate aggregate demand. And in a certain sense, it's even worse than it was prior to 2007, because monetary policy is now the only game in town. And in virtually all countries, fiscal policy is off the table, and the only thing that's out there is monetary policy. And that, I think, is a real concern. And to me, this history makes the prima facie case for maybe what's been happening here is that at each consecutive cycle, the easing has just been setting the stage for still more risky behavior that's led us up to the situation that we find ourselves in right at the moment. Well, that leads on to the next question, I guess. And it's not just monetary policy, it's all sorts of other people too, about why did people do what they did in terms of the excessive lending and the excessive borrowing and all the rest of it. Okay, we had many, many years prior to our getting into the situation in which we currently find ourselves. How did that happen? I want to suggest that virtually every one of these economic agents that I'm talking about was operating on the basis of what I would consider to be false beliefs. And that somehow, as we look forward, we've got to find ways of changing those false beliefs. I guess the first place to start is with the borrowers. In many countries, and I'm thinking particularly about the English-speaking countries, but they certainly were not alone, huge amount of borrowing that in retrospect it turns out was borrowing that couldn't be repaid. Now, why did they do that? I think in a number of countries, they fell into the trap of believing that that borrowed money was the same as earned money, that something was going on where, and we can go back in this question period, on the income distribution side, that was leading to the middle classes being squeezed. And they wanted to believe, and I think the politicians wanted them to believe, that if you borrowed the money, it was just as good to keep up with the Joneses. It was just as good as earning the money. But of course, the fallacy in that is that if you earn the money, you don't have to pay it back. And you don't have to pay it back at potentially a higher interest rate. So we had a problem here. The second thing, and again, I think a lot of people wanted to believe this, is that higher house prices actually increased wealth. That, you know, you were as a society better off with higher house prices. And yet, it's just obvious at the level of the society as a whole that this is a fallacy. Because if the prices are too high, as it were, all that's happening is somebody is selling the house at too high a price to somebody who's buying the house at too high a price. It's a transfer of wealth. It's not a creation of wealth. So there was a, and people, of course, were using the houses as an ATM machine, which is exactly the same sort of thing that I was talking about. The lenders, too, I think, because monetary policy had actually worked so well in keeping the economy going through these cycles, it actually generated, I think, the Great Moderation, you know, which ended in 2007. And I think a lot of the lenders came to believe that, and High Minsky, I mean, if you go back to Minsky and all that range of economic thought, would have predicted this, is that they believed that the world had become a permanently less risky place. So you could make loans that might, in a previous decade, have been thought of as risky, but they weren't thought of as risky anymore because the world had become less risky. Okay, and that too was a fallacy. And even more fundamentally, and I don't know how to deal with this really, is this the belief that near-term profits was all. That somehow during that period of time, the last 15 or 20 years, the ethical system within the banking system changed. It wasn't just a question of beliefs, it became a question of values. That anything that was good for profits, not even risk-adjusted profits, was somehow all right. And now, of course, the bankers are paying billions of dollars in litigation and fines because of that change in their belief system. I think the supervisors made a number of mistakes too. I think right to the end, and maybe still, the basic attitude that the supervisors had was that if the individual banks are healthy, then the system as a whole is healthy. But of course, it completely missed the systemic elements arising from the interdependencies between all of these agents. Okay, the systemic thing that I think is so important in a complex adaptive system, it just wasn't there. And so these people missed a lot. And I think, too, they bought into the integrity of the bankers. They didn't keep up with the changing ethical standards within the banking system. And they believed that the bankers were still operating, as it were, in a spirit of fiduciary trust, which was not true. And what I thought actually was one of the most interesting reflections on this was Alan Greenspan's testimony before a Senate committee. And he was almost tearful when he said that the failure to realize how things had changed and that people working in financial institutions were, because it was in their own best interests, were prepared to take risks that would bring down the firm. He said that was not recognizing that was the biggest mistake he ever made. Well, what I think implicitly what he was also saying was, I may have made some mistakes as a regulator, but I never made any mistakes as a central banker. Okay, but this was the biggest mistake he'd made in the regulatory side. Well, I want to suggest that the central bankers against that background of that slide of all the stuff that's been done over the course of the last 20 or 30 years, that they had some false beliefs too. And I think one of the biggest false beliefs was that because they delivered price stability during the Great Moderation, that somehow macro incidents or macro crises were impossible, okay? Which is back to the first slide, that somehow all of these problems had been dealt with. And we at the BIS always thought that was a bit odd. For a starter, I never did understand how the belief that price stability was necessary could morph into the belief that it was sufficient. But somehow it did. But it was also particularly odd because if you look back in history, okay, about the really big incidents that have occurred in history, there was no inflation prior to the Great Depression. There was no inflation in Japan prior to the Great Recession. There was no inflation in Southeast Asia prior to the Asian crisis, okay? So just on the basis of the facts alone, one shouldn't have believed this. But as far as I could tell, it was pretty generally believed. And even those people who believed that maybe something could go wrong, and Alan Greenspan actually was one of them, which is sort of interesting, maybe something could go wrong, that if it did go wrong, monetary policy could clean up afterwards. And I believe now that virtually everybody would say that belief is palpably wrong in the light of the fact that the crisis started in 2007 and we're still fighting our way through it, okay? It's palpably wrong. And I could give you arguments for why people should have seen it coming earlier. Anyway, so the central bankers too, I think, had some false beliefs. The academics, I've already mentioned that in my first slide, because I think there's this line from Keynes, you know, where he said ideas are more powerful than virtually anything else. And I actually really, really believe that we've had the wrong ideas, as it were, from the academic community for a long period of time. Crises are impossible. But the other thing that I didn't mention that also comes out of modern macro is that income distribution, basically, as you sow, so shall ye reap. Everybody gets paid their marginal product. So as it were, the whole system is just unquestionably fair, and we needn't talk about it, okay? But the thing about it that I guess really concerns me, and this goes back to monetary policy and society, the broader questions, is that as soon as you start believing that, okay, that distribution is not an interesting topic, the whole question of power and the exercise of power and the interrelationship between power, economics, legislation just disappears. And I think that's really unfortunate. And it's something the classics wouldn't have, you know, they wouldn't have missed. Expectations are rational. I don't think I need to say much more about that. It's sort of hard to believe after the crisis that everybody was doing what they were doing, full understanding of all of the stuff that might result from what they were doing. I think the politicians made some big mistakes too. And I certainly see this at the OECD, sort of thinking back about fiscal policies prior to the crisis. The politicians desperately wanted to believe that the boom was permanent. And the reason why, of course, was there just huge sums of money that were going into the exchequers, right, into the treasuries. And they wanted to spend that money. And if they were going to do that, they had to believe that it was there permanently. And the other thing, of course, that was helpful was that as everybody was observing the fact that income distribution was getting worse and worse, if you actually believed that the boom was permanent, you could also believe that trickle down would basically lift all boats. And so you didn't actually need to do anything about distribution. And for those who believed that they did need to do something about distribution, they fell into the same trap as the borrowers themselves. Think about what the US Congress did with respect to Fannie and Freddie and the encouragement of subprime and all that stuff, okay? It's very strong political motivation. The politicians themselves wanted to believe that borrowing the money was as good as earning the money. And that too was a false belief. Let me just say a few words hear about the interactions and I'm between the economic agents. There's plenty of them, and there's many of them. And let me just say a few words about five or six of them, which I think are particularly important. The point that I'm trying to make here, against this background of sort of the thinking about it as a complex system, it's not just the actions of the agents themselves, whether based on false beliefs or true beliefs. It's the interactions among the agents that provide opportunities for mischief. And that's where you have to start thinking seriously about institutional change. So, what are the ones that I'm thinking about? Let me focus on six of these things. The interrelationship between the bankers and the supervisors. There's always the opportunity for regulatory capture. And I think one can make a reasonable case over the course of the last number of years that the regulators in some jurisdictions, I'm not saying all, but certainly in some jurisdictions were not as tough on the bankers as they should have been. And the rotation in many countries, but not all, of people out of regulatory industries back into the banks themselves has not been helpful. Second thing that I think is particularly worrisome is the relationship between the bankers and the politicians. And again, this varies greatly across country. Lobbying, okay? There's been a massive increase in lobbying in many countries in the course of the last number of years. Think about Dodd-Frank, think about the way in which things have been done in some other countries as well. In the US, taking it just beyond the lobbying, taking it to the fundraising, I'm told that if you want to be a senator, it takes you $10 million in order to run an efficient campaign. And there is some evidence that the more money you spend, the money you spend is directly related to the likelihood of your getting elected. Money is really, really important, in the United States at least. The thing about banks is they've got a lot of money. And so that's a sort of worrisome aspect of it. Again, the relationship, too big to fail, okay? People were talking about too big to fail prior to 2007. It's now 2014, and we still have not made very much progress. I think Switzerland, honestly, has made a lot more progress than virtually anybody else. But certainly at the international level, these big global banks, virtually everybody will tell you that we're by no means where we need to be with dealing with the too big to fail problem. The aversion to debt resolution in Europe, but in many other places as well, the unwillingness to sort of say to the bankers, the money's gone, okay? You will never get it back. You've got to write off 50 cents on the dollar, okay? Very little appetite for that. And I can't help but believe that the relationship between the bankers and the politicians has had a lot to do with this. The central bankers and the supervisors. I think prior to the crisis, a lot of stuff fell between the cracks. The supervisors were, generally speaking, not thinking in systemic terms. And the central bankers were pretending to think in systemic terms and writing sort of financial stability reports. But when you go back to what they actually did, okay, there was very little that was done that was actually addressing the character of the systemic problems. Since the crisis, and again, like all virtually everything else that I've been saying tonight, maybe sort of throwing out these assertions as opposed to any hard facts, but I am concerned ex post that monetary policy seems to have had its foot firmly on the accelerator. You know, the stuff that the central bankers have done. Whereas when you look at everything that's going on the supervisory side, it's all sort of it's not in crisis management mode, it's in crisis prevention mode. And they seem to have their foot firmly on the brake, you know, preparing themselves with higher capital for the next crisis. Well, we're still in the middle of the oil crisis that the central bankers are preoccupied with. There's something here, and I just throw this out, but there's something here that doesn't sort of quite cohere between these. And then we have, I guess I'm just going back to what I was saying before, that the interaction between the academics, the central banks, and the politicians, that we've got these false beliefs that sort of seem to be constantly reinforced at all levels, just to sort of keep the whole thing going. I think the relationship between the central banks and the politicians is also evolving and really needs to be thought about going forward. My sense of it is that a lot of things have been going on that constitute a real threat to what people have thought about as central bank independence. And I think it's going to get worse before it gets better. So a lot of the things during the crisis that the central banks did, you know, taking collateral from whom, supporting whom, there are distributional implications for what they've done. And distribution, of course, is the archetypal political act, right? And the central bankers have gone drawn into it. All of this stuff about financial stability, the more central bankers worry about financial stability, the more they have to interact and interact closely with other arms of government that are worried about financial stability. When you think about very low interest rates and who loses and who gains, and I know the CP is actually doing some very serious work on this, you start thinking about the creditors are losing and the debtors are gaining. That is a distributional issue of enormous magnitude. Okay? And will have implications again back on whether monetary policy works to stimulate demand or whether it won't. But in a sense, even more worrisome is who are the biggest debtors? And the answer is the governments. Okay? And the governments, I think, and I know there's a lot of other people, Carmen Reinhart and others, thinking about these issues, we may be on the verge of a long period of financial repression in order to try to gradually work these debts down. But if that's the case, and this is an if that's the case, the central banks are going to find themselves under enormous pressure to play the game. So we have all of these things. So looking forward, I think there's a lot of reasons to start going back, thinking about the whole concept of central bank independence, what it means and whether it's threatened. And lastly, I've got one more slide, the issue of the politicians and the voters. And this is the thing that sort of makes you, how can I say, deeply, deeply worried, because we're talking about human nature here. I guess all the other stuff, in a certain sense, has to do with human nature as well. But the politicians and the voters want easy answers, and the voters want easy answers that pay off now. And that's just the truth of it. And most politicians will not get elected if they tell people the truth. And so the result, whenever there's a really difficult problem, is you kick the can down the road, okay? And you pretend the problem isn't there until somebody else has to deal with it. But of course, if you keep on doing this over and over again, as I say in the thing here, the voters get the government that they deserve. And in the end, of course, this has got to be bad for productivity. It's got to be bad for growth. It's got to be bad for all the citizens. So, politicians and the voter, that concerns me too. Well, this is my last slide. Are we going to get a paradigm shift, a change in beliefs? Are we going to get a fundamental rethink of both our belief system and our institutional structures, or not? I guess I would have thought, on the face of it, that the shock of the crisis, both its onset, which was totally unexpected for most, and its long duration, which is totally unexpected by most, would have led to people going back and fundamentally rethinking, you know? Basically saying, well, maybe this concept that I had of sort of modern macro and a relatively painless restoration of equilibrium and full employment, maybe that wasn't true. Well, the funny thing about it is that neither of these things has happened. When you talk to the academics, when you sort of look at agendas for conferences that I've attended, you know, people are tinkering with their DSG models and trying to introduce a new friction here, a new friction there, but nothing basically has changed. When you start thinking about institutional change, we've got all the stuff in Basel and regulatory tightening and whatever. But when you think about the really big issues, you know, a complex adaptive system, well, why don't we reduce the complexity? Okay? Why don't we think about rolling back globalization? Why don't we think about rolling back securitization? Why don't we think about narrow banking? Okay? There's no appetite for that kind of thinking at all, as far as I can tell. The international financial system, the international monetary system. We have a none system at the moment, okay? In the sense that there are no rules. Everybody can do what they want. So we got into a situation where America and a number of other countries basically said, I have a problem and the answer is easy money. And that means my exchange rate should go down. And then we got the Chinese and all the rest of them basically saying, if you can print the money to get your exchange rate to go down, we can print the money to prevent our exchange rate from going up. And that's precisely what they've done. And it's because there were no rules to prevent anybody from acting in ways that were inimical to the integrity and the good functioning of the system. Everybody can do what they want, and they still can. But nobody's thinking about, I see no appetite for a serious rethinking of these issues. So, why is that? Why has this happened? Daniel Kahneman says, and I think I believe him, that when most people are shocked by stuff they really don't understand, far from rethinking their belief system, they retreat into their belief system. And I think we're seeing a lot of this, that people just go back to doing what they were doing before and basically say it's because we need to do more of it. And that creates, of course, a particular problem in a global economy, because the Europeans are retreating back into the problems of their historical experience, which is the problem is excessive government debts and inflation. And the Americans are retreating back into their belief system, which is it's the Great Depression all over again in perspective deflation. So this is not helpful. And of course, in addition, Thomas Kuhn told us 50 years ago that paradigm shifts are never easy. And there's this famous line that apparently Niels Bohr was supposed to have said, but he never said, that scientific revolutions take place funeral by funeral, which is a statement that when people believe stuff and they believe it their whole lives, they don't give it up till they're dead. And then somebody else comes along and picks up a new way of thinking about things. So here's sort of where we are, whereas, as I put it, I think it's still more of the same. And that's why I think independent think tanks and like the CEP and others are really crucial. Because another reason why people don't want to change, and I should have mentioned this, is because the minute that they open themselves up, any of those agents, okay, and I think particularly the policymakers now, as soon as they say actively, we really have to think again about the fundamental belief system we've got, that is implicitly a self-accusation of I got it wrong the last time. And nobody wants to do that, okay? And the difficulty, in a sense, as I ran through all of those different agents, the difficulty is that with so many people who made so many mistakes, each contributing to what went wrong, it's enormously easy to basically say, for example, I as a central banker, Ben Bernanke said this right up to the last. It's nothing to do with me. It was all a regulatory shortfall. And it's very easy for everybody to do that. So nothing changes. Because they don't want to admit their own complicity in what happened. So I think it's very important that people that are outside that system start to make a stronger and stronger intellectual case for thinking about the basic beliefs and also about the institutional relationships. And I will just finish here. I think there is, in fact, a lot of stuff going on We've got the CP, we've got the new INET group, we've got a lot of independent thinkers associated with the IEA in the UK, thinking about these things. We're seeing a developing literature now on complexity, and I started off talking about that, and I'll finish up with it. A recent book that I just read by a guy called Davison, he's written a book which is called From the Classics, called The Recovery of Classical Economics. And he traces a path, basically, from the classical people through Hayek and the Austrians and the people who worry about complex systems to modern complexity, with all of the thinking that's gone into that. And all I can say, I'm not sort of a great scholar of these things, but even after 40 years in this business, where I guess I've had to spend most of my time saying, I'm sorry, but it seemed like a good idea at the time, I think there are still some openings now at the intellectual level, thinking about this stuff, complexity, and learning from other disciplines, you know, who have been dealing with these problems for a long time. I think it's very exciting, and I think there's still a lot of progress that can and should be made. So I thank you for your attention.
Bill, thank you so much. This was a tour de force. You gave us a lot of food for thought, and that's, I think, also a good basis for 20 minutes of discussion that we now have time for. Please note that this meeting is on the record, so we'd appreciate it if you wait until the mic reaches you when you ask a question, and please briefly introduce yourself. And since I hold the mic, allow me to ask a first question, Bill. You briefly mentioned the term narrow banking. And I wanted to follow up on that also because I know that there is a group in Switzerland that is thinking about that and ask you to expand a little bit on that concept and share with us what you think of it.
Basically, I think this goes back to the Chicago School in the 1930s, and I think Irving Fisher even signed on to it too, which is the idea that you basically take away from the banks the capacity to create money, and which I think many people would feel is the fiat money system is the basis of the excesses that have led us into so many difficulties. And nobody's got much of an appetite for it, because the honest truth is that I guess I myself do believe that there's a lot of room for greasing the wheels through the creation of money via the banking system that contributes to much of the growth that we have seen in the, you know, over the centuries and in the capitalist system. So to my mind, it's sort of a bit like saying, you know, we could stop all air accidents if we only stop people flying. You know, but most people, I think, would look at it and say, well, as much as we want to stop all air accidents, this is probably not the best way to do it. So whether banks, I do believe that in one form or another, banks should be more tightly regulated. I just did a big piece on regulation, which unfortunately sort of led me to the conclusion that there's still a lot of things that we don't really understand about the policies that we're following, that there's potential unexpected consequences. But my gut feeling is that the financial system was allowed to do a number of things that were clearly excessive, and that going forward there should be tighter constraints so that they can't do that. And I think I also believe that the complexity should be addressed more directly. It's sort of not back to narrow banking, but something like trying to stop financial institutions from doing certain things that they are currently doing, which are dangerous and which could infect their capacity to provide basic services within the system. Now, having said that, I mean, there's people here that know this range of territory far better than I do. But having said that, I know there's always the worry then that the more you regulate in one area, the more everything just migrates to a different area, and then you're confronted with another whole set of problems. So I don't profess to have explicit answers on any of this stuff.
Thank you.
Papu. Dr. White, you gave a very interesting presentation, a historical view, and to my mind, the most interesting thing you said was that somehow, and I'm almost quoting you, I think, somehow the system morphed from classical economics to modern macroeconomics. I'd be very interested in your thoughts about that somehow.
I think I used the word morph later on, really having to do with the question of how the belief that price stability was a necessary condition for macroeconomic stability morphed into a necessary condition, into a sufficient condition. And I honestly, I don't know. If you want the short answer, I don't know. But I think a large part of it might have had something to do with human nature. And that was that we were living through the last years of the Great Moderation. And it was just human nature to want to say, we did this, okay? We did this, and somehow we did it permanently, and we've solved all the big problems. And so you got this transition. But the bottom line is I don't really know. On the earlier issue about the movement from sort of the classical way of looking at things to sort of marginalism and the resource allocation way of looking at things, which became central to everything we've done over the course of the last 100 years, again, I'm not enough of a student of that to be able to tell you precisely why that happened and why it went on so long. But what I do think is sort of odd, sort of in the modern day period, is how when you had that period of time when sort of, you know, the stagflation time, and then Volcker came along and sorted the whole thing out, and it was clear that the way that we were doing things could have problems. And yet, sort of on the academic side, somehow we had the reintroduction of all of these sort of, I shouldn't say reintroduction, but the reintroduction of ideas which led you back to the belief that the economy would re-equilibrate itself very rapidly. You know, that somehow that all came back in again, even though the stagflation period had indicated that things could go wrong for a long period of time. You know, rational expectations, the Lucas critique, all of this stuff that just somehow took on a life of its own. And as we say, the rest is history. And it's still there. Still there.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your presentation. My name is Irmi Seidel. I'm economist and I'm working on environmental questions. So I liked very much your statement that the economy is like an ecosystem, but I think we should go further and see that the economy is part of the ecosystem and better understand the ecosystem. And I think if we would understand the ecosystem, we would see that there is no endless growth. We would see that energy is most important, and I think we would recognize the importance of niche, of heterogeneity, of diversity, of complexity, as you said. So, but I think if we understand that, we have to question first the role of economic growth, for example, then also the role of centralization of more global institutions. You asked for a political economic union at the European level. I really question whether this wouldn't increase a complexity which we cannot handle. And then maybe my last remark. You said that since the crisis, hardly political measures have been taken. I'm afraid that no political measures are taken because we have no solutions of which politicians are sure that they work. Because normally politicians take then action when they know that the things they do work.
No, I agree with you, and I think thinking the idea that the economy is part of the complex adaptive system, absolutely right. And I think if I'm not mistaken, Alex, one of the things that the CEP wants to take a look at is the question of the relationship with resource sustainability, which I think is very important. Looking at the economy as sort of a complex system, I mean, one of the first things that strikes you, learning from other complex systems, is that heterogeneity is a good thing. And that once you homogenize everything, I mean, this is the kind of arguments people use in terms of genetic engineering, et cetera, but once you homogenize everything, you're setting yourself up for a big problem. You know, the Irish potato famine, I remember at the BIS, just gut feeling, you know, 15, 20 years ago, thinking about one of the problems with international coordination on the supervisory side is we get everybody following the same rules. And whenever anything goes wrong, they all react in the same way, and all of a sudden a little problem's turned into a really huge problem. Now, I'm not saying any of this stuff is, okay, this is my view. All I'm saying is that there's issues there that I think are serious enough to be discussed seriously by thoughtful people. So, and on the politicians, I think that they're always, as I said before, I think they always take too short a view because their voters want them to. And I guess you're probably right that the only things that they do are the things that they know are going to be successful. And in this particular case, they don't know because it's very, very complicated. So. But the real danger is, and it worries me on the economic side too, is that by the time you realize, because we're talking cumulative dynamic processes here, by the time you realize that you've got a cumulative tiger by the tail here, that things have gone seriously wrong, it's too late to do anything about it. And if that's, I won't say it is a problem, but it sure might be a problem on the economic side and the financial side, if that's the way it works, on the climate side, we have a real problem because the lags and the uncertainties are just so much greater. So by the time you get the will for political action, it may be far too late. And then we'll be into the question of how do you cut the costs of the inevitable.
Thank you. My name is Stefan Illy. I'm an entrepreneur of a small enterprise consultancy firm. And I'm wondering if regulation and even more regulations in monetary system is not the solution. Could private money or bitcoins be the solution for our problems?
I think, and I know Ben Bernanke and others have said that I think what they've focused on is the technology for transferring money internationally, where it seems to be really very cheap. And they used to think about that against the backdrop of all of these, you know, millions of immigrant workers, and you can sort of see that there'd be an advantage in it. But when you start thinking about sort of what's a money, I mean, a money is a store of value. You know, it never goes default. You know, it's a store of value. It's a medium of exchange. Store of value, medium of exchange, unit of account. Well, at the moment, it's none of those three, and I doubt that it ever will become one of the three. So, I think people should try to steal the technology. Some entrepreneur should steal the technology.
My name is John Trepp. I'm an economist working with some left-wing politicians and unionists to reduce the complexity of the Swiss financial system by full structural separations between banks, dealing in securities and savings and loans banks. So my question, you said that false beliefs in monetary policy are reinforced in the interest of the powerful. So my question, who are the powerful?
Well, I guess you'd have to include the bankers and the people in the financial sector. I wonder, too, about the industrialists. I'm not sure what it's like in a country like Switzerland and elsewhere in Europe. But in the United States, as I mentioned, it does seem that there's been a very substantial degree of consolidation in the United States and a marked unwillingness to enforce antitrust laws. And so companies are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And of course, with the size comes the money, and with the money comes the lobbying, and with the lobbying comes the legislation. So I, as I say, I've not looked into the European case at all. But certainly in the United States, and I suspect in a number of other countries too, there is something to worry about. I read a book just recently by a guy called Barry Lynn, which is called Cornered, in the sense of having cornered the market. And he makes some very interesting observations about what's going on in the US. There's another interesting book written by a woman called Jeanine Vidal, who's a social anthropologist. And she got her on-the-ground training in Eastern Europe, watching how what she calls tribes of people associated themselves to basically seize power and use it in their own interests. The book is called Silent Elite. And then she's got a couple of chapters on how exactly the same stuff is going on in the US. So there's a lot of issues out there about, without trying to be a kind of conspiracy theorist, but it is perfectly natural, or it would be perfectly natural, for people who have money to want to exercise power. And they will obviously, most of them, sadly, use the exercise of power in their own interests. And one of the things, I should have known this, but I didn't. Apparently, when you go back to the US Constitution, there was a big debate in very, very early days between Hamilton and Madison and on one side, and Madison and Jefferson on the other. And Madison basically wanted to recreate in the United States the kind of aristocratic sort of rule that they had in Britain, whereas Jefferson and Madison wanted to be very much sort of government of the people, by the people. And when you started talking about controlling monopolies and big firms, the view of Hamilton and Jefferson was that this was very much to be opposed. And they didn't oppose it on the grounds, the economic grounds, that these monopolies or whatever would use the opportunity to raise the price to the detriment of the ordinary citizen. They opposed it because they knew that the monopolies would exercise power in a way that would be undemocratic. So going as far back as that, there was a profound concern about the interrelationship between money, power, and legislation. So I think today, yeah, it's a legitimate question to be looking into without sort of, how can I say, fancy conspiracy theories or whatever.
My name is Roger Koeppel, I'm a journalist. A question is, if you had one wish free and you could see it happen and set it in action, what would you say is the most important problem, concrete problem, that had to be addressed if you were, for example, president of Europe or something like that? What would be the most important problem that you would like to see solved in very short time? Thanks.
Well, very short time. I mean, Europe is not such a good example because, of course, you've got the fundamental problem of the Eurozone, and what needs to be done there if the Eurozone is to be maintained. But I think the question here from the back, which is a valid question, you know, if you really think it through, maybe it would be better if it were not maintained. I guess maybe this just reflects my OECD stuff, but I think there's so many gains to be made from structural reforms, product markets, labor markets in particular, entry into businesses, going back again to ecosystems. You know, what's really important is that new things can come along and get a foothold. What's equally important is that old things that are dead are allowed to die, you know, so you don't keep zombie companies and zombie banks alive. So I would put my focus, I think, at the structural level, because in the end, these structural things are really the most important. Having said that, well, I've already said, I think that a new way of thinking about monetary policy would be helpful as well.
From the University of Zurich. I'm a macroeconomist interested in inequality issues, and I enjoyed very much your presentation. Thank you very much. And I was struck when you said that there is no regulation binding monetary policy choices, and central banks are free to do what they want, regardless of the spillover effects on other countries. And if we think what's going on now these days in the emerging markets following the start of the tapering by the Fed, that's quite obvious. And I just wanted to ask you, as a privileged observer at the OECD, do you see any realistic possibility of monetary policy coordination at the global level in the future? Thank you.
No. The problem is that the US and the Fed is at the center of the whole thing. And what they do really matters for everybody else. But they do not conduct their policy by legislation. Okay, I'm not trying to blame them. They are following American law. And they have got their mandates to be concerned about what goes on in the United States. And that's what they're doing. And the difficulty, and then what they say when the others say, but what you're doing really hurts me. So the emerging markets, the money flows into the emerging markets because of low US interest rates, and they say, this is causing problems. And then the money flows back out again because of tapering, and they still say, this is causing problems. But it's true, because the money is causing problems both when it comes in and when it goes back out again. The underlying problem is that the so-called law of uncovered interest parity doesn't hold. So we have a fundamental market failure here at the heart of everything. So that when you normally think about, let's say the Swiss franc goes up, you'd say, well, it goes up a little bit, and then everybody says it's overvalued. So it stops going up. But it doesn't work that way. Because when the momentum gets started, then people sort of bet on the momentum. Probably in addition, they're investing in things in Switzerland where the prices are going up, so you get a double benefit. So exchange rates tend to have a life of their own, a momentum of their own. So when the Americans say, well, just let the exchange rate go up and you insulate yourself, it could go up to such a degree that you just have a huge problem, internal problem of, you know, who can compete and who can't compete. So I think what we'll find going down the line is that you'll see much more recourse, because it's a market failure, you'll find much more recourse to things like macroprudential instruments, capital controls, both going in and going out, which is probably not such a good idea. I guess what I would like, as I said in my presentation, I'd really like people to recognize that the system is broken. It's a nun system. There's no rules. For example, there's no rules to force the country which is the world's biggest debtor, the United States, to do something about its debt. There's nothing to force any of the big creditors, like Germany and China, to stop amassing still more financial assets. Okay? Recognizing that in the limit, if these credits become too big, that's the basis of the crisis, because people can't afford to pay it back. So there ought to be some rules on both the creditors and the debtors to say, behave in a way that supports the integrity of the system. But there is no rule. And there, as far as I can tell, there's no appetite for it either. So another issue that I think needs debating. I'm not here with any, I want to be perfectly clear, I'm not here with any answers, but I'm here to sort of ask questions that I think deserve to be asked.
Oliver Adler from Credit Suisse, also an economist. I guess my first comment is that I'm a bit surprised that you're putting so much emphasis on complexity, because you're lecture was actually very straightforward and very clear. And so my sense is that actually maybe your statements could be turned into pretty simple models, and you don't really need that much complexity. You know, myself, sort of being a, I guess, believer in two models, the ISLM model and the solo growth model, don't really want to talk about ISLM, but more about the solo question, I mean, which picks up on your comment on structural change. My question is, do you really believe that what monetary policymakers do will fundamentally change the long-term growth path of the world economy, you know, according to, say, the factors which Solow has described?
Yeah. Well, just for a starter, without sort of getting into the technicalities, because I've probably forgotten them all, the idea that growth is driven by undifferentiated labor and undifferentiated capital, that there's just a lump of something out there called capital, I think is probably not a very good place to start. And as you know, there was a huge debate in the academic literature in the 1960s between the two Cambridges, Cambridge MIT and Cambridge UK. So I'm not sure that that's sort of a really good place to start. What I would say is the following. We've had this huge crisis. The OECD has already sort of their contention is that potential, the level of potential, is down by about 3% in the OECD. So we had a major shift down in the level of potential. And people in the States have firmly denied this up until now, but now you're hearing with guys like Larry Summers and others gradually signing on, well, maybe there's a problem. The other aspect of it is that there's been this growing recognition that, certainly at the OECD, that the heart of progress is innovation. And I guess I really, you know, it's here in the human mind more than sort of a lump of capital. But the point is that innovation at various points needs money. And I guess what I worry about is that if you get a crisis where the financial system has been seriously affected, that the capacity then of the financial system to provide the finance to support the innovation is reduced. And then we have a longer run, then we have a longer run problem. And I would note against that background that Ken Rogoff and Carmen Reinhart become ever more pessimistic. So Reinhart and Rogoff wrote the first piece in which they said, you remember 800 Years of Financial Folly? Where they look back and they said, well, basically, you know, if you get a crisis where the financial system has been impacted, either because something has gone wrong in the financial system to start with, or because you get a recession, which then feeds back on the financial system and weakens it, and then that weakens the real side, okay? Doesn't matter how it works. If the financial system is hurt, these recessions go on for a long time, okay? So, a long time. And then Reinhardt, Carmen and her husband, Vince, did a paper at Jackson Hole, and I was the commentator. And they focused on the same database, going back 800 years, but they focused on the 10 years after the crisis. And basically what they contended was, sometimes it took 10 years and you weren't even back to where you were before, okay? And remember now, in the UK, Europe, I mean, you're still operating. I mean, aside from Germany and the US, all of the countries are still operating at levels well below the peak level before the crisis began. So anyway, Reinhardt look at it and they say, 10 years later, oh, I've still got a problem. Well, I was just reading in the paper the other day, they've got a new piece. Now, this one's Reinhardt and Rogoff again. And they've expanded the 10-year period. And basically what they're saying is, it can go on for 20 years. Well, is that permanent? Permanent enough for me. I think 20 years is a long time. So there are a lot of reasons to believe that, that these monetary cycles, you know, this boom-bust thing can have real implications that go on for very long periods. And we haven't even spoken about the distributional thing. I mean, one of the things that, I don't know, I mean, I leave it for the CEP, but talking about low interest rates, okay? I did a paper a while back which has been published, but it was originally done for the Dallas Fed. It was called Ultra Easy Monetary Policy and the Law of Unintended Consequences. And one of the things that came through very clearly in the research that I had done was that low interest rates and these successive cycles, but particularly since 2001, basically gave enormous impetus to the shadow banking system, okay? And what I would call the increased financialization of the economy, okay? A lot of people in that industry making huge sums of money, okay? With a big impact on the distribution of income. And as I said before, to make it worse, you got the money, you use it to support your own interests. So power buys stuff. And that becomes a threat not just to the markets, but really to the whole political and social structure. So there's a lot of big issues having to do with, you know, money having implications for the real side of the economy and beyond that into the social and political aspects of the economy. Just questions to think about, you know. Just simply saying money is money has nominal effects, you know, on prices. That's it. And it happens soon. I just don't think it's true.
We've already gone way into overtime. Room for one last question, quick one.
very quick one, thank you. Name is Stefan Kuhn, KPMG. I was just wondering, considering Switzerland's very small country, small fish in the pond, perhaps in a nutshell, what would your advice be for, let's say, Swiss government regulator or the, let's say, National Bank?
Again, I think consistent with the sort of complex sort of approach that I take to it, one of the things that you're led to is that virtually all policies are sort of state contingent. So that you've got to look very carefully at where you've come from before you figure out where you're going. And the honest truth is, I don't know enough about Switzerland to be able to say with any authority that people should be doing things differently. And since I've known Thomas Jordan for a long period of time, the idea that I would state publicly that I think he's doing things wrong, don't think would get me very far. So I've nothing to say in response to your eminently sensible question.
Great. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Unfortunately, we need to end.